I'd love for each of our panelists to just start off by sharing why you chose to participate in today's panel. Dr. J, I think I have a hunch about that. So maybe we'll start with Dr. Sandy and Dr. Grenot-Scheyer.
I'm happy to go ahead and start. It's just, first of all, the opportunity to be with other people focused on something besides COVID-19, fires, climate issues, politics, economic upheaval. I mean, this is a very focused group, and your focus and your presence give me, feed my optimism about the future. And I think we put a real stake in the ground around residency as a vital pathway for teacher preparation in this state, and that the residency lab has been a key part of stabilizing and making that a very real community. So that's why I'm here. And thank you, Jessica and Jacqueline, for inviting me. It's always a pleasure to share this space with you and, of course, with Dr. Marquita Grenot-Scheyer.
Well, thank you and good afternoon, everyone. I hope everyone is safe and healthy. And as Mary said, I am so pleased to join this conversation to really focus on the kind of good work that's happening in our universities and in our school districts. And anytime I have the opportunity to share the mic with my dear friend, Mary, I'm happy to do so. I think all of you know that educator preparation programs work really, really closely and really, really well and really, really effectively with Mary and her staff at the commission. And that was so clear this past spring as we worked together to figure out how to minimize the disruption of the dual pandemics on our candidates and their future students. So I'm very pleased to be here and very happy to share the screen with these incredible colleagues. And I want to make sure that I acknowledge all my CSU colleagues. That was a very generous introduction, Jessica, but I do this work alongside campus deans, faculty, and staff on behalf of our students. So thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. J, you are welcome to also chime in on that question if you would like.
I'm just grateful to be here with you all to have this conversation to really highlight what I think is a courageous and bold direction with regards to the work in the lab and teacher residencies in general, and that is a focus on equity. So with that, I turn it back to you.
Thanks. And I wanted to, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention a tool that we're going to use after this as part of conversations among participants, but also we invite you to use it already. It's a Padlet. Essentially, it's like having a virtual place to put some sticky notes. Except sticky notes always fall off the wall. This one actually sticks. So if you take your phone, you can just put it on camera mode. Dr. J is showing us and hold it up to the QR code there and just click yes or enter when it and invites you to join that website. If you'd like to use it on your other devices or a laptop, the link to the Padlet Jesse just pasted into our chat box here. So you're welcome to share any reflections, insights, ahas, just so that we can keep track. I will ask you to put questions that you'd like to pose to our panelists today in the chat box, but this will also be a tool we use in our conversations later. So just a little bit of housekeeping there. And while I do that, we already mentioned that we're in the middle of an unprecedented time. Many of the overlapping pandemics our communities are experiencing are actually not new. But when we think about the future, I'm curious for each of our panelists to share what you think the ideal future for teacher preparation looks like in California, and maybe one or two opportunities and challenges you think to reaching that ideal future. So, Marquita, do you mind if we start with you since Mary started the last time?
Happy to. Thank you so much. You are absolutely correct that these times are truly unprecedented. And these two pandemics, the COVID-19, has shed a really harsh light on the disparate realities in our schools, as you said, that have been present for decades. And so I am optimistic and hopeful that we won't return to normal through the collective work of people such as yourselves because normal wasn't working for Black and Brown and poor communities. And so through the work of the residency lab and your focus on equity-driven, clinically rich teacher preparation programs, I don't think we will. I think we will come to new ways of providing schooling for all students. And so when I think about essential elements of teacher preparation programs, I reflect on the work in our system with the New Generation of Educators Initiative. I see a couple of my colleagues who have been involved in that work. This work was supported by the SD Bechtel Jr. Foundation, and it resulted in some really important and meaningful lessons that we are building upon and attempting to scale and sustain as we move forward. So those essential elements are collaboration among district partners and teachers and families to ensure effective schooling for all students. Deep partnerships where partners could come together to determine those prioritized skills and knowledge that all candidates need to have. Building these relationships, and I was talking to some folks the other day, and codifying the roles and responsibilities and how we do our work together. So after the project is gone, after the funding is gone, is that university and district partnerships have these roles and responsibilities built into how they do business. Of course, meaningful, rich clinical experiences under the support of well-prepared mentors and teachers, and then, of course, continuous improvement to continue or to support our efforts to improve. So this inflection point is providing us with that critical opportunity to step back and to look at our educator preparation programs. And that's exactly what my colleagues are doing in our campuses right now, as we increase, as we emphasize our work around diversity, equity, and inclusion.
I really want to agree with Marquita, not for the first or last time, I'm sure. To put a fine point on it, COVID-19, you know, caught us all flat-footed, right? We've had notions about what we were doing, some driving themes about what we were doing to prepare teachers that included student-centered teaching and learning, that included a focus on equity, that included a focus on social emotional learning and trauma-informed practice. You know, these have all been elements. We have in our standards and have for years had an expectation that teachers would be prepared to work in online and virtual environments. But COVID-19 shed a harsh light on all of these notions. what it means to do student-centered, student-engaged teaching today is so much different than what it meant 8 months ago, right? You have to find them. You have to get them into a space like this. You have to get... you have to have reasonable work for them to do that they can do. You have to think about the time they're with you and the time they're not with you. I've learned, and I'm using these words, synchronous and asynchronous, just like they're normal. They're the new normal, right? So I think every single educator, as they started the school year this year, was about reinventing their practice in a very big way. And I really want to underscore the point that Marquita made. What we have been doing, our normal, had a number of features to it that sounded really good, but the outcomes weren't working for every student. And this moment gives us a chance to rethink that. We have to reinvent our practice at every single level. I have to reinvent my practice at my level, and God knows the teachers, the early childhood educators, the faculty need to reinvent theirs. So when I think about what some of those key features need to be and what we've really learned in the last 6 months about our system, flexibility. We have to be ready to adapt to the moment. You know, with fires, with pandemics, with the kinds of social unrest that occur, the more we are engaged with one another, teachers have got to be able to pivot and reach students where they are. And while I think that's always been a driver, that has been one of my drivers as a researcher in teacher development, we have to double down right there on teachers having a range of skills that they can bring so that they can bring students into the work. We have got to accelerate our learning about how to design impactful learning experiences for children in this kind of space. I went to a seminar that Audrey Gomez, who I see is part of this, with the Thompson Special Ed Group at Chapman University. I went to a webinar they put on about using technology to advance universal designs for learning. And it was sobering for me and humbling for me to see a whole vocabulary on the screen that I could not, I couldn't understand. I didn't know what any of these links were to or what on earth I would do with them. Okay, so I'm not a digital native, I'm a learner, but there are huge arrays of strategies and resources that we need to become very facile with in teacher preparation, in the faculty ranks in teacher preparation, and in the schools. And so that's where I think our future lies in terms of the future of preparation, is really innovating and learning how to deliver in a whole different way.
Well, I like the sound of your futures, so I hope your crystal balls are as accurate as possible. Dr. Sandy, you slightly answered something that was my next question, but I want to invite you to elaborate on it. In terms of teacher preparation right now, what do you think is the most immediate urgent need that we need to think about? Is it that digital literacy and that pivot point? Is there something else as well?
Well, yeah, I think it is. It's an array of things. I mean, this this moment we find ourselves in at home, families are disrupted in enormous ways. Educators are disrupted in enormous ways. I think, you know, besides becoming very adept and facile with virtual learning and how to structure that in ways that engage and move students forward, and that's just foundational. We don't know enough about that, and we have got to double down on working on that. But we also have got to deal with trauma-informed practice. We've got to strengthen our ability to help students who are experiencing loneliness, mental health, stress, isolation from one another. You know, the schools are created to be socially interactive environments. And so much of our learning, I think we have depended on that social environment where students are together and engaging with one another to move forward. And that has been, they've been so far removed from that. I think that's something we have to deal with right now, is how do we reach children and help support them in their emotional, social and emotional needs. Again, these are things that we've called out for years in the standards that we set, but the moment is right now. The moment to use these skills and really sharpen these skills is right now. And I think there are a number of ways in which we could be about that. The commission has been doing more and more webinars, more and more office hours, more and more convenings of practitioners to discuss problems of practice and to work on strategy pathways together. I think we need to do more of that. We are about to release a letter to the field where we're going to put a strong point on the collaboration, which Marquita talked about, and particularly we'd like to advance residency models at this very moment. We need the hands-on that student teachers and their master teachers can bring working together to innovate in their classroom. So I think that's my bucket of things that are urgent right this very moment.
I couldn't agree more. I'm going to pivot to Dr. Grenot-Scheyer, although I'll give Dr. Jay a heads up. I'm going to come back to you and ask for a little bit more of your thoughts on the connection between social-emotional learning and trauma and residency. But Dr. Grenot-Scheyer, we've seen some interesting side effects of COVID-19 in terms of higher levels of enrollment, especially for Black and Brown educators. And I'm curious for your thoughts on why you think that is and what the implications might be moving forward.
I'd be happy to reflect on that, but can I just add a couple of perhaps opportunities that build on what Mary talked about in terms of what we need to include in our teacher preparation programs. I think we need to be explicit and direct to ensure that our candidates are being prepared in anti-bias, anti-racist curriculum. This time that we find ourselves in, we don't want to lose this opportunity to really deepen the understanding of our candidates and to ensure that their clinical experiences help them understand the kind of curricula that needs to be delivered in deep and meaningful ways. We need to really make sure candidates understand culturally responsive pedagogy and instructional strategies. We need to make sure they understand how to collaborate alongside their colleagues and families within a system of multi-tiered systems of support. I'm going to call out an organization that Mary and I and many of you that I see are engaged in, and that's the California Alliance for Inclusive Schooling. This is a grassroots organization of folks who came together a year and a half ago or 2 years ago because schools weren't working for all students at that point in time. So we need to make sure our teacher preparation programs provide all educators with an opportunity to learn with each other and by alongside each other to ensure that all students are well served. And then the last piece in teacher preparation that I want to make sure we call out is that our candidates understand and embrace the assets and gifts that all of our students and their families bring to the curriculum. And I think working with families has just been really highlighted this past spring as educators have had to figure out how to deliver curriculum alongside parents and aunts and uncles and neighbors to make sure that students' learning was not interrupted. So to your question about a side effect, the CSU is experiencing increase in enrollment across the whole university, not just in teacher preparation. But what my dean colleagues have shared with me, that their enrollment is just, in some cases, skyrocketing. And is it because of the executive order that our governor signed in the spring and then extended for this coming year, perhaps? We know that candidates can postpone the assessments that were required for the preliminary credential, and we also know that the CSET has been suspended to enter a preparation program. So is that allowing more candidates and more diverse candidates to come into the field? Perhaps, but I think we need to watch this very carefully. I think we need to study this very carefully. I know my colleagues are very interested in seeing the trajectory of these candidates that we have admitted and making sure we don't lose them along the way. And we are doubling down our efforts to recruit candidates of color, but at the same time, we're looking very carefully at our practices. And I'll call out the Educator Quality Center. I saw a couple of my colleagues on the screen. About a year and a half ago, the Educator Quality Center brought some data to our dean's group where we sat down together and we looked at the demographic profile of our candidates. Some of you know the CSU, about 40% of our candidates are Latinx, 37 white, 9% Asian American, and depending upon the year, 2-3% African American candidates. So when the dean were faced with that data in such a striking way, we committed system-wide to look at this situation using improvement science methodology. And so we have developed a learning lab for diversity where 5 campuses are coming together to study what is happening with their candidates all along the way from the point of admission and certainly retention. We're looking carefully at advising structures and then eventually what will happen at the end. So with this particular cohort of candidates that we admitted, we've got to follow them carefully to see what their trajectory is.
That is so helpful to sort of pull back the curtain and make us think a little bit more deeply about the context there. As promised, Dr. J, I'm going to turn to you and first of all, invite you to comment on any of the answers thus far, and also just help us crosswalk trauma-informed practices and social-emotional learning with everything we're talking about today.
Thank you. Yes, first of all, I agree with everything that everyone has said. I do, I'm very excited to see the boost of candidates of color entering teacher credentialing programs. And I too am excited to see what happens as they progress in the, throughout the program, but also as they progress in their teaching career. I say this because although I know that we've had wonderful and we continue to have wonderful and fantastic credentialing programs, teacher residency programs, there is something that is occurring that I would say, for lack of a better word, is pushing some teachers out, some candidates of color out especially. And so when I think about the conditions and the conditions of our programs, the conditions of the workspace, you know, working conditions, the climate, are we truly being as inclusive and supportive enough to ensure that when we have an educator of color on campus or on site, that they know that they are a part of that teaching community, that they are a part of that schooling community, and that their voice matters. I mean, and I think if we all think about that, I think we can say sometimes that happens, but more often than not, it doesn't. And I see that reflected, obviously, in the numbers. I will say with regards to trauma-informed practices and this focus on social-emotional learning, absolutely, we need to do that for all of our students. But I firmly believe that in order to do that, we have to have educators who are also whole, right, and supported and able to deal with their social emotional learning needs as well as any trauma that they may be experiencing. And so educator well-being, I think, should also be an essential element to this work. Even before the double pandemics were occurring, teachers were experiencing secondary trauma just by the magnitude of things that their students were experiencing. But when you compound that with what's happening with COVID-19, all these issues of race, right? And you have your students experiencing that stress and the teachers experiencing that stress, it can be quite overwhelming. As a matter of fact, I know that there are a lot of teachers, and maybe you know too, who feel like they're working all the time. They basically live at work, right? And that there's never enough of a break or a support. And so I'd just like to see how we can make this standard protocol in all of our credential programs.
Thank you, Dr. J. We're having some fantastic conversation and questions in the chat. So yes, we will save these as well, but thank you to those who are pasting in really interesting resources and thoughtful questions about data and not going back to our testing regimes and things like that. I wanted to invite each of you, I know we're running a little behind and I wanna make time for a Q&A, but I wanted to invite each of you to comment on why you think it is that we haven't necessarily centered the success of teachers of color in our programs thus far. And you know that we really need to see a shift and an opportunity here. Why do you think that is? And also, if there's any sort of thoughts or advice you have about how we don't lose the flexibility and lose, for example, what Dr. Grenot-Scheyer said about some of our changing demographics.
Well, shall I start, Mary? So I think within the CSU, I think we have been very intentional with our recruitment preparation, and perhaps less so with the retention piece, because they're all now out of our hands when they leave us. But with our residency programs, we have a built-in model to ensure that we don't lose track of our graduates, that we continue to be part of the educator community that supports them. Because what we know from research and from practice is that we lose teachers of color at a greater rate than any other group of teachers. And we know why that happens. We know about the importance of leadership, and we haven't talked about that in today. I know we all understand that, but having that supportive, thoughtful leader is critical to retaining our teachers. We haven't talked about working conditions. We haven't talked about salary. We haven't talked about a lot of those perhaps issues that are out of our control, but as a community, we need to address them. And I think the residency lab is a perfect place to do that. So maybe the silver lining from this spring is that it allows us to, again, refocus on that whole trajectory of the teacher from when we admit her or him to when they become that seasoned teacher leader at a school 10 years later. And that we continue our intentional and focus efforts. And we work alongside our philanthropic partners. I'm not gonna call out anybody this afternoon, but there are many people on this screen who have been incredibly supportive of our candidates through scholarships and other kinds of support. And this past spring, many of our foundation partners have reached out to us and said, how can we help? We're invested in teacher preparation in the state of California. We want to continue to help all of us collectively get around this corner. So that's a silver lining that I hold on to.
Again, I find myself saying ditto to Dr. Grenot-Scheyer. And really, so this, a month ago, about 80% of our staff at the commission participated in an implicit bias training program offered by Dr. Anthony Marks. And it was, you know, for all of us that thought we knew all about that, and that our own practice was not informed by implicit bias, but, you know, we're very explicit allies, you know, we're woke, right? not as woke as we need to be. And I think we all came away from this very powerful training. At least I came away from it with a very deep sense that this has got to be central in our work to prepare the education workforce, especially given the gaps we have in representation in the teaching workforce. If we're going to recruit teachers of color, and I'm speaking to the choir here, it is clear that we have got to be about uncovering and discussing and getting comfortable with the notion that we all experience implicit bias and we all bring it somehow. And to have strategies that are really targeted and focused on mitigating that when we're engaging with each other as professionals, when we're engaging with the students that we teach. Right there, that's got to be core. And what falls out from implicit bias becomes systemic racism. And if we want to break down these systems, we've got to start with this self-examination. So that was a key epiphany for my team at the commission and something we are working with the commission on. How do we push that concept through and use racial equity as a lens through which we look at all of the work that we're doing? I think that's a critical aspect, at least from my level, of what's necessary if we want to see and encourage and bring a more diverse workforce into the work. I've seen in some of the comments going by on chat, questions about testing and the role of testing at sorting people out of this profession. And this year, unfortunately, we had a very short and focused legislative session, and the only bills that got through had to do with COVID-19. And as much as we tried, we had a couple of sponsored bills that were intended to move our testing programs, CBEST, CSET. Well, let's just talk about those two for a minute. CBEST and CSET, moving them to a platform where a person could take that test, use it diagnostically, and take coursework or in some other way demonstrate their competence and keep moving rather than getting stuck in that hamster wheel and not being able to move into preparation. For the commission, that reflects a view that there are multiple ways to demonstrate that you have the content foundations to begin teacher preparation. But going back to your early question, what do we need to do in preparation? Preparation has got to be about picking up and working on content-based pedagogy very powerfully so that the people who come out of teacher preparation know what they're doing and know how to engage the curriculum as they're engaging students. So our bills didn't get through this year because they didn't have a direct COVID impact, but we're looking at reintroducing, we will be introducing them again in January. The goal being to create multiple pathways for people to demonstrate their readiness. Those already exist for CBEST, but for CSET, we've got a very kind of monochromatic approach to this, and it is really past time to fix that. The RECA test is another example of something that people get stuck at that point in preparation and spin their wheels and take and retake and retake the same test over and over and over again. We want to break that up. And there have been, there's legislation that again didn't get through this year, but may get through next year that can help us do that. So I think these are critical pieces. The third critical piece, and we were just so excited with the governor's budget in January and the prospect that we were going to invest real money in eliminating teacher shortages and diversifying the teaching profession. Thankfully, we had enough funding and were able to get 38 grants funded. And you all are the recipients of those grants for the residency program that allow for local recruitment of people who are in your communities and giving them the space and the support they need to become fully prepared teachers. Critical that we make the investment. I heard John King about an hour ago talk about we're at a New Deal point in terms of what we need to do in education if we want to transform it. And we ought to take the fact that everybody's up and on their feet and deciding whether they want to still be in this profession or leave it and enrolling in greater numbers than we've seen in a decade. And that's an exciting moment. There's a lot of energy and a lot of movement, but we can take hold of that, I believe, and shape the future. And that's what I think is critical to get diversifying this profession right back in the center of our work.
I put the hashtag energized in at the beginning, but I was wrong. Now I feel energized. So I appreciate those remarks. And you know, one of the many jewels I heard from all of you was it's past time to fix this. And also Dr. Grenot-Scheyer talking about the transitions and supporting those transition points as well and seeing people through the process as opposed to sort of good luck on the next part of it. Dr. J, you're our host, and I know I'm running late. So I want to check with you on if you'd like to answer that question as well. And perhaps as part of that, I know we have a number of questions, but one in here was, how are we ensuring that all teachers reflect on their positionality and the hegemonic stories of white supremacy in order to implement anti-racist teaching practices and lens? Could you maybe help us transition to the way you're thinking about doing that moving forward?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, everything that has been shared thus far really actually are highlighting what are the key components of residency programs. You know, obviously working in partnership with your school districts and the universities, working on the clinical practice and that relevant coursework that makes sure that teacher residents leave the program ready to teach on day one. And I also would like to say that there's been, you know, it's part of it. You know, there's a focus on recruitment of diverse, high quality candidates, especially educators of color. And I think what I like about the lab is that because of all of you here, you know, we have the ability to make a huge shift in our teacher preparation system and in the way that we are preparing educators. We have the ability here to intentionally focus on advancing equity with a calling out of saying, you know what, we are going to intentionally work on our working conditions. We're going to intentionally work on our programs so that when we recruit African-American educators, when we recruit Latinx educators, that when they enroll, that they are going to be supported to thrive and to stay in the profession. And I know Mary Sandia really appreciated, or Dr. Sandia, I appreciated her comments around that implicit bias training, because one of the things that came out of our work and our discovery process was not only was this twin pandemic causing so much stress, it also brought up a lot of questions, like how do we deal with this, right? What are we going to do? And in the lab, we have the ability to offer capacity building sessions that will help us have those conversations around implicit bias in teaching, that will help us help shape the basic philosophy of teaching of every resident that leaves our program and shape it in a way so that it isn't biased or isn't racist. We have the ability to do that now, right, by the work that we're doing to ensure that our teachers are leaving with an anti-racist teaching philosophy. And you'll see in some of the offerings what we're going to show with you later on, those are the things that we are focusing on in the lab this year.
Thank you so much. I'm going to hand it over to you in 1 second, Dr. J. I'm going to mention two things. One is a reminder of the Padlet. I'm going to invite Jesse to put the link again in the chat, just for those of you who haven't posted your virtual post-it note of any ahas or thoughts there or questions for us to visit, since clearly we need a part two of this conversation. The last thing I'm going to ask our panelists to do is offer a headline. What is the headline that people need to think about today? Certainly there's plenty, but is there a headline that you want to make sure people walk away with? It's a totally unfair question. It's a lot of complexity. It's like asking for your favorite movie, I know.
Well, it's probably more than a headline. I want all of you to know how we stand shoulder to shoulder with you to support this work. I have the benefit of getting to see how the faculty work with their district partners and the amazing work that you're doing. And I am in awe of all of you. And so please know you have me and all of our deans and all of our faculty standing by you to support your work, and thank you so very much.
Well, if that constitutes a headline, then I'm in luck. Thank you. You know, we've been driven by such an impoverished view of, driven by shortages, that for many, many, many years, every time we hit a teacher shortage, we start thinking, how do we make it easier? How do we get more people in? We take the path of least resistance because the imperative to staff classrooms trumps everything else, right? For the future, you figure out, somebody who's a communications person, make a headline out of this. We need to get rid of the impoverished view of this. We need robust teacher preparation. We need to be ambitious about that. And residencies are that. That is, this is a view of teaching that takes it seriously and that makes it possible for people who come in to get the skills they need, to get the mindset they need, to have the mentoring they need, to stick with this, and to only stick with it if it is for them. I think we're going to lose people. I think we're going to lose a lot of people who are in the workforce right now who don't feel the call to the challenges that we're facing right now. And that's okay, because if you don't feel it, I'm not sure you can do it. This is a profession for people who want it. So here's my headline. Come on down.
Dr. J, I mean, the only thing we're missing not being in a room together, aside from nobody having a commute, which is great, is we don't get to hear the huge round of applause, yes, I'm sure that our panelists would be experiencing right now. Dr. J, I'm going to give you the last word on this, but you all have reactions on the bottom of your screen. Feel free to use whatever you've got going on there in your version of Zoom.
Yes. Thank you all for sharing your amazing wisdom with us today. I think I learned a lot. And one of the things that I appreciated is knowing that we're not alone, right? You're not alone in this effort to really focus intentionally on recruiting, retaining, and supporting educators of color. So my last word would be have courage and get gutsy, right? To do the work that you know is right, because you're not alone. You've got people who will stand with you side by side doing the same thing, Okay. I think that if all of us collectively, each and every one of us, just think about this, if we all collectively committed to focusing on the recruitment, the retention, and support of educators of color so that they will enroll in the programs, that they will thrive, and that when they leave, they are completely and totally equipped to teach our diverse student population, we will make a huge shift in the system. All of us doing that. So get gutsy, get courageous. And with that, thank you all for this amazing conversation. We're gonna transition into some insights and reflections, but let's give everyone a round of applause. If you can show your screen. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. Again, I just wanna say how much gratitude I have for our panelists today. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much for really putting it out there and showing that it's okay to focus on the things and the students and the efforts that we know need more support. And so at the lab, we really feel like we can play a pivotal role in advancing equity and supporting everyone to recruit, retain, and support a diverse teacher workforce. So our mission here is very clear. We want to strengthen California's capacity to provide equity-driven, clinically rich teacher preparation and support. And we want to ensure that California's prepared or powerfully prepared, diverse, and thriving teacher workforce advances educational equity and justice, providing the learning supports that ensure every student reaches their potential. Because let's face it, right? We're not just recruiting teachers to recruit them. There's a reason why we need teachers. And there's a reason why it's so important, especially now, that the teachers who leave these programs can teach all of our students, because we need it. We can't let our students continue to languish in the background, especially our English learners or African-American students or Indigenous students or special education students. We need to make sure that these educators have what they need to ensure that our kids are learning and thriving. So here's our focus for the year. And Sherry, I'm going to invite you to talk a little bit about the evolution of our offerings here.
Yeah, sure. So for those of you who don't know me, I think I know a lot of you. My name is Sherry Staub, and for the past couple of years, I've been consulting on the statewide California Teacher Residency Lab project in a variety of ways as coach and consultant to the CDE Foundation, as a member of the kind of founding team of us who mightily decided to take on this effort of bringing a learning community of teacher residency partnerships together, as you see on this slide in front of us, to kind of learn from one another, strengthen our partnerships, strengthen one another's programs and curriculum, and kind of just in informal and formal ways support one another to continuously improve as we rise to the challenge that Marquita and Mary and Jacqueline so eloquently kind of articulated for us at the beginning of our session today. So maybe move to the next slide, Jacqueline, and I'll talk through kind of the evolution. So, you know, when we first launched the lab idea and the model for this network a couple of years ago now, it was on the off the heels of the statewide, you know, ridiculously generous investment in teacher preparation and in the teacher residency model. And we were really excited about bringing you and community together to think through the kind of building blocks of teacher residencies. We called it the pillars, or our path, or our journey last year. Those of you who were with us last year for some of our in-person convenings and the support that we were able to provide as a technical assistance community. In between those convenings, we looked at kind of the building blocks of partnerships in a teacher residency model, the structures of the curriculum, and the alignment between coursework and clinical practice in a residency model. We looked at how to support mentors in a learning community and to grow as teacher educators in a residency model. and we thought deeply, or just started to think deeply about recruitment and retention and what that looks like and how to structure our programs to have a lot of the key pillars and components of what we know successful residencies across the country to have. And we worked with the National Center for Teacher Residencies, the California Alliance for Inclusive Schooling, Trellis Education Partners, a variety of technical assistance providers together, West Ed, to bring some of those offerings to everybody. And what we've realized this year is a need from you, because through our strategic, what did the GPG group call it? Our strategic statement of strategic direction work, and the work we did and the interviews and focus groups we had with so many of you, we heard that you wanted all of that we did last year, but really wanted to focus on how to support teachers of color to thrive in California, how to recruit and retain Black and Brown teachers, multilingual teachers, teachers that we heard earlier, and students that we're not serving. And we wanted to kind of take advantage of all that we'd started in terms of the building blocks of residencies and kind of figure out a way to pair together the call that we all want to rise to this year to offer some really powerful experiences to do exactly what Mary just talked about around finding opportunities to examine our own implicit biases before we can move forward and advance in our work and our curriculums in order to use racial equity as our lens. So we really felt it was important to center teachers of color in our program and our work as a lab this year. And that's why you see the kinds of opportunities you see on the screen here. And so we're going to dive really deep into the pillars of residencies around curriculum and mentor development and support and partnership, but we're going to do it through a focus on equity and on meeting the needs of California's diverse students and diverse teacher population. And so that's kind of where you see that popping up in a lot of ways. So over the fall and the spring will look similar. There are some kind of optional offerings and some kinds of offerings that were hopeful, and I believe, Jacqueline, on the next slide, there'll even be an opportunity for folks to register right now or to scan the registration link that folks will take advantage of. And there's some choice in there. So we'll have an annual year-end conference towards the late spring, summer, and this annual launch event kind of to kick off the special events and offerings section of the lab's work, which is really exciting. And while this year's annual year-end conference may be virtual, the plan is in future years, once we get the pandemic under control, to come together in person as a community and really learn from the field, from one another, and propel our work together. And then there are kind of two paths that programs are able to choose from to really kind of operate as if we're one big, large learning community. These are the opportunities for nested communities of practice to learn and work together on a particular focus area. And one is going to be presented by Dr. Travis Bristol in collaboration with the Residency Lab around supporting and retaining teacher residents of color through a deep examination of the curriculum that programs are putting forth and the kinds of experiences and opportunities that are being offered to candidates. And so that's kind of where that path's focus will be. And the second path will be on an opportunity to work with Magali and Elvira, who were also with us last year as technical assistance support providers and are with us again, to really look at how we're serving English learners across the state. So what does it mean to center equity and instructional practice around equitable learning and to meet the needs of our multilingual students and our English language learners? And so that's really exciting. And we're going to ask that, if we haven't already, I believe in a lot of the correspondence Jacqueline sent, including some of the commitment letters, that you're choosing one of those two paths to be able to really zone in on as a program. But then through these monthly consultancy sessions that I believe we're launching in December, you'll have an opportunity to learn from one another's path experiences. And here, if you haven't been, you know, deeply involved in the work with Dr. Travis Bristol or our colleagues at SEAL, you'll be able to hear from your partner programs, your colleagues and other programs around what's learning and what's happening there, as well as shared challenges and problems of practice. And then we also just wanted to kind of offer a few other kind of opportunities to build our program's capacity to do our work well in this crazy time. And so one is around, I'll start from the bottom, this idea of clinically rich teacher preparation online and remotely, and what it means to take what is such a, you know, Jessica, Jacqueline, and I joked about how, like, and I've had conversations with many of you around, how do we, the residency model and clinically rich preparation is predicated on the belief that training teachers or preparing teachers to learn how to teach in a classroom setting in front of students alongside mentor teachers, that is like so foundational to the model. And COVID is requiring us to flip that on its head and take that model and put it into a remote platform and setting. And not only that, but to change the way we teach, how we teach, how we support our mentors online and remotely. And so we're just gonna spend some time with a few opportunities actually throughout the year to dive deep into what that looks like and how to strengthen our programs and our own pedagogical strategies and the way we approach our programmatic design remotely. We'll also work with a team from WestEd on the idea of implicit bias and systemic racism in schools, and work once more with James Gallagher, who many of you were able to meet in our social emotional well-being kind of culmination of year one webinar last year, to do some more mindfulness work, not only for ourselves, but in order to understand how to integrate that into our curriculum. So diving really deep into the curricular components of residency models this year and how to center equity in those ways. And for a lot of these capacity building opportunities, residents and mentors from your programs are also welcome to join, which we're really excited about.
I will say this, now that you've seen what we're offering, and now that you've seen the different dates and how you can come and pick and choose, I expect to see you at these events. You can at least do one, right? At least one. You're here right now, so you can do at least one more, right? You've got the annual event and some of these other sessions. Take advantage. We are here to support you. But more than that, we want you to be able to support each other as we get gutsy, right? And engage in this work. So you could, you know, you can indulge me here and maybe give me an emoji or a thumbs up or a something in the chat that lets me know that I'm gonna see you at more than one event, right? You'll be here, right? Let me see, I'm looking, I'm trying to see. Okay, I want you to look at each other now so you can hold each other accountable as well. That's wonderful. Thank you. Okay, look, you all are important. The work that you're doing is ensuring that every single student in California has teachers who care about them, who are competent, who reflect their diversity, and who just want to make sure that they are able to thrive. So I need you to take care of yourselves. Okay? So I'm just going to read this to you. Okay? And it says, practice self-compassion. Love yourself, be kind to yourself, extend the grace you would afford anyone else going through tremendous turmoil to yourself. You are worth it. You matter today, tomorrow, and always. With that, if you would like to stay in touch with us, feel free. I will send out these slides in a follow-up so that you have all of the information we discussed today. And we bid you adieu. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Bye, Jacqueline. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you all for joining us. And thank you again to our panelists. You were fabulous.